Let's now look at the transition to planet formation. So we form a disk that has a high concentration of solid particles that slowly start to grow. So how do these solid particles evolve? And for that, let's first look at the dynamics in a disk. So what are the forces actually acting on these solid particles, on these dust grains and small particles? So first of all, we already saw that the disk mass is much, much smaller than the stellar mass. So the gravity in radial direction, which is given like this, will be not neglect, will be given here by this, by the mass of the stellar object and the distance. But we will also have the attraction of the disk itself. So the disk will look about like this. So the most mass is in the star. So the star acts gravitationally on the material. The disk itself, for a particle here, for example, will act vertically and radially. So the radial contribution depends on the material distribution inside and outside, of course, and it will be negligible compared to the contribution of the star. So that's meant what is written here. But in C direction, so this is the C direction here, then of course a dust grain here feels attraction by all the material below it, so it will feel an effective force downward, while materials here will feel an effective force upwards, and over that time this then will concentrate the material in the central plane. When we look vertically, we will have here this contribution. So again, C is the distance above the midplane and omega is the angular disk. So that's the contribution of the star. The contribution of the disk is given by the surface density, and the ratio between the two is given here and can be written as Q half, where Q is the Toomer parameter for a Keplerian disk. So what this tells us is that the vertical gravity of the disk is unimportant as long as Q is significantly larger than 1. And we saw from the initial estimates that for a minimum mass solar nebula, Q is in the order of a few tenths. So unless we are in the outer parts of the disk, the stellar gravity will dominate. There are other forces on the solids that we have to consider, and that is drag. So drag means that drag happens always when a solid particle moves through a fluid, through a gas that is relatively at rest, then we will have collisions between the gas and the dust and the solid here. And this will either hinder, or if we have the opposite scenario, might possibly accelerate this the solid particle. So even though this can be very complicated, we can estimate the drag force on small, slowly moving particles. We assume that they are of spherical size, a spherical shape. They move through a gas with density rho and sound speed c, and their velocity is v relative to the mean velocity of the gas. Then we can write down the collision rate, and this is like this. If our particle is at rest, then we will have same number of collisions from all sides. So momentum transfer will cancel out, and we will have a net zero momentum transferred between the gas and the particle. However, if it's moving, then we will have front side collisions. If it's moving, then we will have a different momentum transfers for collisions here compared to collisions here. And the difference will be that for front side collisions, the average velocities will be the mean gas velocity plus the particle velocities, and on the rear face it will be minus the particle velocities. So we will have a net momentum transfer per collisions in the order of the mean particle, the mean gas mass times the velocity. So the net rate of momentum transfer, which is the drag force, is about the product of this times the number of collisions per time. So we will have this drag force. And the C is some constant of order unity that accounts for the shapes of the particles. When we now integrate over the Boltzmann distribution of these solid particles and assume elastic collisions, then we find a CD in the order of 4/3 pi. And this is then called the Epstein drag law. For larger bodies, they experience the so-called Stokes drag, where we change our dependence from S squared rho V times C to a quadratic dependence on the solid particle velocity. So that's the drag force, and when we now look at the settling, then of course we have already mentioned the gravitational force by the disk itself, but when we have a star, then any particle here will of course feel a radial force, but also a vertical gravity component of we'll feel the radial force here, and the vertical equation of motion can be written as the sum of the vertical acceleration here plus the drag minus the drag force divided by the mass of the particles. So the acceleration due to the drag force. And this can be also written here with this differential equation. And the form of this differential equation is that of a damped harmonic oscillator. So this can be solved analytically as long as the density here is constant. And then we find the time of these damped oscillator given by that. So for large sizes, we have a weak dampening, which means large particles are not stopped before they reach the midplane. So they oscillate back and forth through the midplane while they rotate around the star. So we will have a rotation up and down, which of course also then increases the passings through the disk and therefore also the number of collisions these particles experience. However, when we look at small sizes, the dampening becomes strong and we have an exponential slowed down drift to the midplane, and they will not oscillate. And then there is the critical size, with the minimum settling time, and this is in the order of 850 centimeters times, of course, the distance from the star and the density. So this means that all objects that are smaller than about 10 meter sized boulders will slowly drift down to the midplane without oscillating. So we will increase the number of these particles in the midplane. When we are much smaller than these critical sizes, then the time it takes for these objects to settle down in the midplane is in the order of a few hundred years. So that means a 1 centimeter grain will move down to the midplane basically immediately. While one millimeter sized particles will take longer. So this sedimentation of course takes place parallel in to the coagulation. So while they move through the disk settling down, they also grow, so this changes, of course, the time, the settling time. So the growth helps particle sediments to sediment faster, and sedimentation raises the density, so they will automatically collide more often, so they will grow quicker, and so on. When we look at the radial drift, then we find that the gas in the disk, of course, is supported mostly by rotation, plus some pressure support. So, which means that the orbit of the gas disk is slightly slower than Keplerian velocities because we have some additional pressure which is slowing down the velocities somewhat, but preventing it to spiral inward, as would be expected from a solid body in a Kepler orbit. So the gas disk, as a result, rotates a little bit slower than the disk of the solid particles, the dust disk. And that's because solid particles do not feel gas pressure. So the dust particles are typically faster than the gas velocities, so they will constantly feel a drag depending on the velocity differences, which can be expressed like this. And at a distance of one astronomical unit for our minimal mass solar nebula, this is in the order of 70 meters per second for number density of 1. So this drag will take away angular momentum from the solids and move it and transport it to the gas. So which means that the solid particles will start to spiral inward just because they are constantly slowed down. And this inward movement has a stopping time, so the time to eat up the entire velocity that is given by this. When we are at very small particles, the stopping time is much, much smaller than the orbital period. So, which means that small bodies, small dust particles, are always constantly forced into a co-rotation with the gas. They move inwards a little bit, slow down, and then they are at the same velocity as the gas again. And then they feel drag force again, and so on. So the drift velocity will be much smaller than the ratio between the stopping time and the period time will be much smaller than 1. And of course this inward drift speed rises with the particle size. For large bodies, the stopping time will be much larger. So, which means that the drag will be not able to force these bodies into co-rotation. So the large bodies always move almost Keplerian. And the drift velocity is proportional to the size of the particles according to this relation. But this means that we will have an intermediate size with maximum drift speed and minimum stopping time, and the drift rate reaches a maximum for objects that are about 1 meter sized, with a lost time in the order of hundreds of years. When we are at kilometer sized objects, the drift rate is back down to give lost times of a few hundred thousand or a million years.